summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above. Join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide. Strength for today and bright hope for tomorrow. Blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see.
Father, thank you so much for the day that you have provided for us. And this song echoes our heart that, Father, tonight we want to say, great is your faithfulness. You're so great and you're so faithful. Thank you for providing for us, for giving us this opportunity to pray, to receive encouragement from the Word of God. Be with all those watching by way of live stream, those that are going to watch later by way of the video. We thank you for them and bless our church. Continue to give us your grace and help us, Father, to draw closer together with you and with each other. In spite of the physical separation, we are united together by the bond of fellowship in the Holy Spirit. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Please be seated, and we'll turn over to hymn number 95, one we haven't sang in quite some time. But again, wonderful song. No one ever cared for me like Jesus.
I would love to tell you what I think of Jesus, since I found in him a friend so strong and true. I would tell you how he changed my life completely. He did something that no other friend could do. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. All my life was full of sin when Jesus found me. All my heart was full of misery and woe. Jesus placed his strong and loving arms around me, and he led me in the way I ought to go. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. Oh, how much he cared for me. Every day he comes to me with new assurance. More and more I understand his words of love. But I'll never know just why he came to save me. Someday I see his blessed face above. No one ever cared for me like Jesus. There's no other friend so kind as he. No one else could take the sin and darkness from me. mighty care for me.
Amen. Isn't those great songs? Got one letter I want to read to you tonight. This is from the Warrens in Alaska. And he's got an update, so just sit back and listen to the stories. A lot of neat things happening up there in Alaska. We had several visitors during the month of December and January, with two young preachers from the road system in Alaska flying out to preach before Christmas. One of Rebecca's sisters flew up from Florida. Another friend of the family flew over for Christmas. It was nice to see them. In the last few days of December and the first few days of January, two friends from Georgia flew up to help me work on the building as it had gotten terribly out of level again. We appreciated the fellowship as we usually don't get many visitors in the middle of winter, and we're grateful for the preaching, testimony, singing, and physical labor that was done by these fine folks. The two young men that came out before Christmas were Nathan and Caleb Pinnix, brothers from Palmer, Alaska. They both preached here in St. Mary's, brought a used snow machine out with them from RAM Ministry. That's Remote Alaska Ministries. Missions. Remote Alaska Missions. Donated to the church here in St. Mary's. And let's see, he goes on. Remote Alaska Missions, a ministry that we are part of that goes to villages without churches by boat, snow machine, and plane to spread the gospel by any means possible. While they were here, we did some remote Alaska missions work in Pilot Station, the next village upstream on the Yukon River, going there by snow machine and passing out Bibles and praying with households. While there, a man named Michael Tinker invited me to come once a month to read the Bible, have a church in his house. Praise God. Pray that the RAM ministry there continues to grow. We are grateful for the snow machine, the blessing it was to help minister in Pilot Station. I'm guessing a snow machine is a snowmobile, right? Yeah. The two brothers in Christ from Georgia, Jonathan Henry and Jerome Stratton, were a blessing, leveling the church building in sub-zero weather as it had gotten bad out of level. They had originally planned on doing trim work in the church auditorium, but one end of the building had gotten so far out of level that I was worried about the structural integrity of the main beams of the building, so leveling it became a priority. I appreciate their help as my knee was bothering me greatly at that time. They gave their testimonies in church, which was a blessing. Many people out here do not have a testimony of salvation, and it was of great spiritual value to have their testimonies told to the people who attended that church service. Later in January, as I was scouting out a route to the village of Unalakleet through the mountains so I could get there to preach at a later date, the snow machine that had been donated by RAM in December blew its engine almost 100 miles north of St. Mary's. Please pray that I'll be able to get it before spring break, break up to get it back to the village. So I guess it's not spring break, but spring break up. Okay, that's the ice. Fortunately, a young saved man from church had accompanied me on this trip, and I rode back with him. Else, I would have been a long walk back 100 miles north. I was able to make it back to Pilot Station to do the RAM ministry one more time before the engine blew on the trip north into the mountains, so praise God for that. This has been a very cold winter with the spells of below zero temperatures lasting much longer than usual before it would get back above zero. But we have been kept warm with the wood stove heat, and we are thankful for the food that has been sent by churches and individuals through the mail, fruits, vegetables, snacks, seasonings, etc. We've had a much healthier and varied diet during these dark months of winter than we would have had otherwise. It has kept our morale up and our health good, which is important when the sun doesn't shine much. We are planning for the summer already with VBS to get ready for, starting to scout out the land for a suitable place to build cabins for a youth camp. Listen to this. Getting as much firewood as possible by boat, ministering in other villages by boat, and the never-ending work on the church building here to continue getting it in shape. God is good, and we are glad to stay busy in His service. Pray for wisdom as we plan. It will be May before you know it. The ice on the Yukon River will be breaking up, and we want to be ready. We will need to get a Honda ATV to use to haul logs up from the Yukon River to the site where we will be building a youth camp, as to make a 9-foot by 9-foot cabin that is 8-foot tall. I will need about 100 logs to turn into the walls, floor joists, and beams, rafters, planks for decking for the floor and roof. That is a lot of logs. So we will definitely need a Honda to drag them up from the river. We will also need a bunch of 10-inch Timberlock lag bolts to fasten the logs together with, and 2-inch, 3-inch, and 4-inch nails for the roof and floors. All of this work will be done about 30 miles from the nearest electricity and electricity. So I need to plan ahead and make sure I have everything we need to get the job done in advance. Please pray that the Lord provides the material to build at least one log cabin this summer and fall. Rebecca has been able to reach out to several women in the village through her ladies' fellowship once a month, witnessing to one in particular who asked for Rebecca to share the gospel with her. None have been saved, so please pray for their souls in Christ, Brother Warren. Okay, so let's just pray for him for a moment. Just his whole life is like a story, and it's just amazing what he does all the time. And I still remember when he first went to Alaska, and I thought, you know what, if anybody could make it there, it's definitely you. He lived out in the woods out here with his family and then took them all up there. Rough life, but God is using him. And so thank the Lord for Brother Warren, and let's just pray for him, okay? Father, I want to thank you for the update that we have received. And I know this is already the month of April, and so this is a couple months old. But we thank you, Lord, for what you have done over the winter months. And we do pray for continued blessing as Brother Israel is trying to plan for building a log cabin. We pray for him to get that Honda ATV that he's looking for. We pray for his snow machine, for the motor to get repaired. And we pray for the spiritual blessing to be able to see more people get saved. Lord, thank you for him. Thank you for his ministry, his family. And we pray that you would bless him in a mighty way. We pray for Rebecca as she witnesses to the women, that, Father, she might be able to share the gospel and they might be able to see some more people get saved. So continue to work with them and encourage them along the way. Lord, thank you for our missions program here at Cross and Crown. Help us to be faithful as we give. We pray for all of our missionaries that you'd meet their needs. Help them as they all are suffering as well because of the schedule changes, the coronavirus that's affecting the world. We pray that you'd help them as well, especially those who are financially strapped, those who can't get food. We just pray for a special blessing and grace and mercy. Help them all. And thank you again for allowing us the opportunity to give and to pray. So bless now, we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, Pastor Miles.
All right. We on, Josh? All right. Welcome to those who are physically here, those who are here in Florida, those who are watching from Tennessee, from Nevada, from Nebraska, from New York, from Virginia, and Texarkana. And if there's anybody else I miss that's watching out there, we just want to thank you for tuning in tonight. Steph, I hear you were watching last week like a good girl, so I assume you're doing the same tonight. Elliot, can you pass me some chips? Miss Teresa, what are you knitting tonight? Brenda, are you listening from the kitchen baking a pie? I can't imagine any more spiritual endeavor except if Brother Scott and Robbie are cleaning their guns. Robbie, Lynn, and Dustin, thank you for inviting me into your living room. I will try not to make a mess. Last Wednesday, I was a good boy too, and I kept it under 20 minutes. Let's see if I can manage to do the same this evening, though I will not make a promise I can't keep. What an amazing God that we serve, who can speak to all of us tonight, wherever we are. And he can even use this lesson whenever you're hearing it, whether that's 2 or 3 days from now, or whether that's 2 or 3 years from now. I just marvel at God's power to be able to use someone so simple in a far more powerful way than I ever could have imagined. So will you pause wherever you are, whatever you're doing, and pray with me right now that God will do what only he can and use his word to communicate through his spirit to you right now. Gracious Heavenly Father, Lord God, we just want to take this opportunity to come before you and praise your name, Lord God. You're such a good God. We want to thank you that we can be in your house tonight. Father, we want to thank you that we have health. Lord, we want to thank you for my son's toe, for how you took care of that. Lord, I ask now that you would cleanse me of sin, that you would empty me of myself, and that you'd fill me with your spirit so that you can communicate your word to your people. In your name we pray. Amen. Stephen Covey in his book, Seven Habits of Highly Effective People, said this: sow a thought, reap an action. Sow an action, reap a habit. Sow a habit, reap a character. Sow a character, reap a destiny. Anytime I read a book, I'm constantly considering whether the claims made by the author are in line with or against what Scripture says. I find rarely can anybody be neutral. You're either agreeing with God or disagreeing with God. Some people in our day and age think they've stumbled onto some new idea. They think they've found some knowledge that has not been known to man. But as Solomon says, there's nothing new under the sun. So let's see what God's word has to say about that idea. If you want to turn, you can turn to Proverbs chapter 4, verse 23. A verse likely familiar with all. It says this: keep thy heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life. What does it mean to keep? Does it mean to wrap something up so that it can't escape? Is our heart trying to leave our body so we must put it in a cage? If I give you something important and I said to you, I want you to keep this thing for me, maybe you would take that thing and you would put it in a safe and lock that safe, and then we'd walk away and it would be kept in that safe. But if we were to use the movies for a definition, which is where I get all of my spiritual information, we would say, when you see in a movie where somebody gives somebody something so important, it's important, it can't fall into the wrong hands, they will have it on their person, not just in a safe somewhere. Or they may even have it in a briefcase handcuffed to them, because they can't risk it falling into the wrong hands. It's so important. They're guarding that thing. No one is going to get access to that thing without their authorization. What is our heart? Is it the blood-pumping organ in our chest? And that's why God gave us ribs, so we can keep our heart. The heart is the center of hidden emotional, intellectual, moral, and spiritual activity. It's the part of our mind from which everything else flows. So we are to guard our emotional, moral, and spiritual decision-making center. We are to ensure there is no unauthorized access, that no one can plant a seed, no one can plant the thought without us verifying that thought, without us approving that thought, after we've compared that thought against the Word of God. What else does the Bible say about the heart? Proverbs 23:7 says this: for as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, he saith to thee, but his heart is not with thee. Based on this verse, we can say that as we think, in our heart is who we are, or is what we do. So as humans, we think in the seat of our emotions, and then we act. So our thoughts control our emotions, and our emotions control our actions. And thus, we must learn to control our thoughts, and thereby control our emotions and our actions. So what that Stephen Covey guy said and made millions on, God already said. Thoughts build habits. Habits build character. Character determines how we live our life. And that makes me think about the sin cycle in James. James 1. Let no man say when he's tempted, I'm tempted of God. For God cannot be tempted with evil, neither tempteth he any man. But every man is tempted when he's drawn away of his own lust and enticed. And when lust hath conceived, it bringeth forth sin. And sin, when it's finished, brings forth death. So we're tempted when we're drawn away of our own lust. If we're keeping our heart, if we're guarding our heart, if we're protecting our heart, then we'll stop it right there, and it'll never turn to sin. Many people let their minds wander around like crazy monkeys, things just going on all over the place. If you ask them, what are you thinking? They'll say either nothing or everything all at the same time, because they have so many thoughts up there. And sometimes you find there's a thought up there that you didn't approve. Where did that thought come from? How did that thought get there? And you stop yourself immediately and go, we're not thinking that thought. We have to be so very careful to guard our thoughts. Because once we have a thought, we tend to associate an emotion to that thought. Boy, it would be nice if. Boy, I'd like it if I could. Man, that's. And we associate. And then we act on those emotions that we've associated with the thought. And that's when we sin. And that brings forth death. Maybe not physical death, but Pastor Davis and I both in the past have talked about how living in sin quenches the Holy Spirit. When you choose to sin, when you choose to continue in sin, when you choose to live in sin, when you choose to have a sin in your life that you refuse to get right, you limit the ability of God to direct you in your life. And you can end up like Samson. And I've said this before and I'll say it again. This is the scariest thing in the Bible, I think, to me. Samson, he got up and he broke the fetters. And he got up, and after they cut his hair, he didn't realize that the Spirit of the Lord wasn't with him. And he got up thinking, I'll do the same thing I did every other time. But the Spirit of God was no longer on him because he had sinned. And I think you and I should be afraid, because we can sin and we can ignore that sin and we can ignore that sin and we can think, I'm fine. I still have the power of God on me. And then when something traumatic happens in our life, we get on our knees to pray and there's no power there. It's so very important that we keep our hearts, that we guard our hearts. It's important that we develop thought patterns that will help us to build good character traits. It's important, too, when we talk about character, that we consider what character is not. Character is not an outward appearance, though your outward appearance can reflect your character. I love the verse in 1 Samuel where it says, But the Lord said unto Samuel, Look not on his countenance, nor on the height of his stature, because I have refused him. For the Lord sees not as man sees. For man looketh on the outward appearance, but the Lord looketh on the heart. We know what this verse is talking about, how Samuel went to Jesse's house and each one of the sons passed in front of him. And each one of the sons looked great on the outside. And I'm sure time and time again, as the guy walked up, Samuel thought, this is... And God said, no, I want that scrawny, skinny guy out there who isn't even here. We look so much on the outside, and even when we look at ourselves, we can look at the outside of ourselves and think that we're doing fine and think that we're great, but we can be destroyed within. We can have sin in our lives. As we come to church, it's important when we talk about these things, and this is so important, that we ask ourselves, how am I doing in this area? How am I controlling my thoughts? How am I controlling my emotions? Is there sin in my life that I need to do something with? Not say, boy, the person next to me, I hope they're listening. Not, boy, I wish brother so-and-so is watching on the internet, or I hope sister what's-her-face is here, or man, my buddy from work or the guy I know from school could use this. It's important for each of us to look at our own life and to ask ourselves, where am I in relation to this? Am I guarding my thoughts? When we talk about habits, there are many habits that we have, some of which we call routines. And maybe during this time of COVID, you're having an issue. Maybe your routines have been broken up. Maybe your routine's been upset. And maybe without thinking about it, without consciously falling into, you've fallen into a new routine, you've fallen into a new set of habits without even thinking about it because things have just happened and now you're moving in a different way. We've talked about Hebrews and about laying aside every weight and every sin and that idea of weight, an unnecessary bulk, a bad habit, something that you're just dragging around that has no good for your life. But as much as it's important for us to get rid of bad habits, it's very important for us to have good habits. During this time when your schedule has already been upset, when maybe you have a few more minutes to the day, what better time to establish some new habits? There are two new habits that we know are indispensable to the Christian life. These habits are so well known to all of us that right now Logan is jumping up and down on the couch screaming, I know it, I know it. Okay, Logan, what is it? I say, the most important habits to the Christian are prayer and the study of the Word of God. It's hard to say of the two that one is more important than the other. Prayer is our communication with God. And if you permit me tonight to pick a bone with a dead man, John R. Rice has a book about prayer. And I've heard a lot of people say, this book's so great. And I read the book, and you and I talked about it. The book frustrated me because he says prayer is asking and answered prayer is receiving. And we've spent a great deal of time talking about what prayer is. And if you'd like to know more about that, please look on our YouTube. We have got several sermons about that. But the first part of prayer is, Our Father, that art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. The first part of prayer is acknowledging who God is and how holy God is. And nothing about that is asking. We also have to say, thy kingdom come, thy will be done. Another very important part of prayer is submitting our will, submitting our desires, submitting our dreams to the will of God. And nothing there is asking. But if prayer is a habit, is to be a habit, how often should one pray? You're all probably expecting me to read 1 Thessalonians 5:17 right now and to tell you to pray without ceasing and pray all day. And that is indeed something that we ought aspire to. But you cannot continue in prayer. You cannot pray without ceasing if you, at the very least, don't begin your day in prayer. Talking about making prayer a habit, there's a young man we've got to talk about. You all probably are thinking of Daniel. And in Daniel 6:5, it says this. Then said these men, we shall not find any occasion except against Daniel, except we find it against him concerning the law of his God. Then the presidents and the princes assembled together to the king and said to him, thus, King Darius, live forever. And all the presidents of the kingdom and the governors and the princes and the counselors and the captains have consulted together to establish a royal statute and make a firm decree that whosoever shall ask a petition of any god or man for 30 days save thee, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing that it be not changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which are not altered. Wherefore, King Darius signed the writing and the decree. Now when Daniel knew that the writing was signed, he went into his house. And his windows being opened in his chamber toward Jerusalem, he kneeled upon his knees 3 times a day and prayed and gave thanks before his God as he did aforetime. He prayed 3 times a day. He gave thanks 3 times a day. Do you know how you can, and this is a universal, do you know how you can predict any person what they're going to do tomorrow? Look at what they did yesterday. Very rarely is somebody going to do something so dramatically outside of their character, dramatically outside of what they did tomorrow, than what they did yesterday. And we see here that they knew the way to catch Daniel was to write a rule that had to do with his God. They knew Daniel would pray because Daniel prayed yesterday. Daniel prayed the day before that. Daniel prayed 3 times a day last year. It was something he had been doing for a long time. It was a habit he had established. 3 times a day. There are times in my life where I have indeed been able to spend three separate amounts of time in prayer. I would eat lunch quickly and pray during my lunch. But at the least, I think we should pray 2x a day. I think first it's very important for us to begin our day in prayer, and we've talked about Ephesians 4:18, be not drunk with wine wherein is excess, but be filled with the Holy Spirit. Most people take that verse and they skip that verse and go right to all of the verses after it, which are talking about relationships, husbands to wives, wives to husbands, parents to children, servants to masters. But we can't have a right relationship with our wife or our husband or our servant or our master or our children if we don't first have a right relationship with God. So we've got to spend the first part of our day. We must start our day in prayer, getting right, talking to God, finding out what God wants for us. And I think you're all familiar with a quote that it said of Martin Luther. Martin Luther, you have so much to do today. How can you spend 3 hours in prayer? And he said, I have so much to do today, I'll never get it done if I don't spend 3 hours in prayer. And so often, because of our schedule, the first thing we cut is our prayer. If we want to accomplish, if we want to be right, we must pray. It's important at the end of the day that we pray and confess any known sin. And that's important for 2 reasons. One, so we can rest. I think one of the reasons that some Christians struggle and they're miserable, and maybe they don't realize it, is because they're struggling with the guilt of sin. They know they've sinned, and rather than confessing that sin, rather than seeing that sin as sin, rather than confronting that sin in their own lives, they justify it. And then they ignore it. And sin builds upon sin. And David talked about how he made his bed to swim all the night long, and his bones waxed within him. The saved person living in sin is the most miserable person alive. Because when they go to church, they don't fit in because they're living in sin. And when they go out in the world and they act like the world, they don't fit in because they're saved. Confessing sin will allow a good night's rest. The second reason is because sin builds upon sin and puts distance between you and God. We talked about the sin cycle. First, we're tempted. We're drawn away of our own lust. If we're keeping, if we're protecting our heart, then we can stop it as a thought and it doesn't turn into an action. If we're keeping a short account of sin, if we're confessing sin every night, we can look throughout our day and see where we had an issue in our mind, see where we were tempted, and we can confess it and we can forsake it, and we can then put in place a verse to memorize, to recite to ourselves the next day, and we can then do what Jesus said for us to do, and we can ask for prayer to resist that temptation specifically. But if you don't confess your sin, at least every night before bed, when you wake up the next morning, that sin's still going to be there. And when you wake up the next morning and that sin's going to be there, you're going to say, oh, I can't pray. God doesn't want to talk to me. I've got this thing between us. And you're going to go about your day. And it's going to come night. And you're going to say, well, I didn't pray this morning. I'll just keep going. And it'll be days. And then days will turn into weeks. And weeks will turn into months. And then you'll have thoughts. And those thoughts will turn to feelings. And those feelings will turn to actions. And you'll find yourself in sin. And what should have been a habit of prayer has now been hijacked. And you've got a habit that's keeping you from prayer. But prayer is only one of the two habits that are critical to the Christian life. Prayer is you talking to God. But God speaks back to us through His Spirit with His Word. Time and time again, I ask God, God, what am I going to preach? I don't know what to tell these people. I don't know what they need to hear. What am I going to preach? And probably 8 out of 10 times, God doesn't say, I want you to preach on greed. No, God will give me a passage. He'll bring verses to my mind. And then I'll start to study those verses. Oftentimes when I'm asking God for wisdom because I have a decision in my life, God doesn't say, turn left at the next stop sign or the bathroom is the third door on the right. He'll bring verses to my mind with principles, and those principles will tell me the way that I need to go. Psalm 119:105, thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path. Psalm 119:130, the entrance of thy words giveth light, it giveth understanding to the simple. That's where I had finished the sermon originally, but I kept thinking, that's not necessarily encouraging. It's true, it's a promise, it's what we should do. But where's the encouragement? Where's the promise? And as I thought about it and prayed about it, like I said, the Lord brought Psalm 1 to my mind. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that bringeth forth his fruit in a season. He also shall not wither, and whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. Walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. The person who guards their heart, protects their mind, takes every thought captive, and is not allowing counsel of the ungodly. Stands in the way of sinners. This is guarding your heart by guarding your way, by guarding your surroundings. Many times people are not cautious about the situations that they get themselves into, and they find themselves pressured to sin. Had they guarded their way, had they not gone to that party, had they not gone to lunch with those people, they would not have been tempted to sin. Sitting in the seat of the scornful. This is guarding your heart by guarding your emotions. Many people are driven solely by their emotion. They let their feelings determine everything that they do. And many people choose to allow the emotion of anger and the emotion of hate to control them. But the person who has guarded their mind has guarded their emotions and will not be scornful. The person who's guarded in all of those areas will have a habit of spending time in God's Word. They'll delight in the law of the Lord. They'll be in that state of unceasing prayer. They'll be thinking about Scripture and talking with God as their day goes on. But here's the promise, here's the rule, here's the guaranteed results. Guarding your heart, guarding your mind, guarding your emotions, the results of making prayer and study of God's Word a habit. He shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth fruit. This reminds me of what Jesus said when he talked about abiding in him. He said, you'll bring forth fruit, you'll bring forth more fruit, and you'll bring forth much fruit. If we're guarding our minds, if we make a habit of prayer and study, then we'll grow and we'll produce fruit. And I think there are two types of fruit in the Christian life. There is the fruit of the Spirit, love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, meekness, temperance, faith. Against such, there is no law. These are things that are going to be in our life. They'll grow, they'll produce, we'll see them coming out of us when we guard our hearts, when we make prayer and study a habit. Another type of fruit we produce is leading others to Christ, bringing souls to Christ, and then seeing those souls producing that fruit of the Spirit. whatsoever he doeth shall prosper. The last promise from that verse. We must be very careful here. Some would say to me, Pastor Mowers, I'm reading my Bible. I'm studying. I'm praying. I don't know what you're talking about because I was just fired. I'm broken. I'm living in a car. I think as one reads the Bible and one spends time in prayer, the areas that we desire to prosper in, what we consider prosperous, what we consider success, changes. We no longer desire to prosper in the things of this world, but we desire to prosper in things that have an eternal value. Paul said, we don't chase after corruptible crowns, but ones that are incorruptible. And as we become more like Christ, as we spend more time yielding our will to God's will, as the Holy Spirit directs us in prayer, knowing what to pray for and how to pray, we begin to see immediate and powerful answers to prayer. And the things we're doing start to prosper because the things we're doing are the exact and perfect will of God. When I was at Enrichment Conference, Johnny Pope talked about how the Holy Spirit helps us in prayer. And I just want to show you that. Titus, will you come up here real quick? It was a very simple illustration, but it was amazing for me. If you'll just stand right there, act like you and I are holding a log. So Titus and I can see each other, and we're going to move this log, and we're going to move this log like this. And sometimes I might know where the log needs to go, and I can move that log. But if you've ever moved furniture with somebody, I can see what Titus is going to do. And Titus might move in a different direction than I move. So I know which way to move. But we're both bearing this burden. We're both carrying this weight together. And sometimes I need the Holy Spirit to guide me. And he might be able to guide me just with his eyes. I might see, hey, this guy's, the Holy Spirit wants me to go there. Well, I might need to move there. But we're both bearing this burden together. And for me, that was just a really powerful example to see it that way. And if you've moved stuff with somebody, you kind of know. If you've moved the same thing with a person more than one time, you know which way they're going to turn. You know which way they're going to go. And having that relationship with the Holy Spirit in prayer, being able to carry that burden and him to guide us, to lead us with that burden is so powerful. As I close, I want to tell you a story that I heard another preacher tell. And this is the story. There was a church. And I have to assume that the church was up north, because as you walked into the church, there was a place to hang up coats. And in the south, you don't see coats all that much, I suppose. And as you walked in, there was an usher who was assigned to help people hang the coats up. So you would go there, and he might help you take your coat off and hang it up. And right in the middle of the sermon, the preacher hollers, "Somebody's stealing the coats! Someone's stealing the coats!" And everybody just sits there and doesn't do anything. And then the sermon is over, and everybody goes to get their coats, and their coats are gone. And they're super mad at the preacher. He said, "But I warned you. I told you somebody was stealing the coats." And they said, "Oh, well, we thought you were just preaching." Tonight, consider again how COVID-19 is affecting your life, how it's affecting your routine. Maybe your routine has been upset. Maybe you've begun a new habit that's keeping you from Christ. Tonight I've sought to show you how one simple habit can make or break you, how a habit turns to thoughts, feelings turns to actions. I've warned you to guard your heart, and I've told you to make prayer twice a day a minimum habit of your life. I've advised you to study God's word daily, and it's during times like this when we are under pressure but we're alone, we don't see our brothers and sisters in Christ as much, that our character becomes apparent. What is this time revealing to you about your character? Are you realizing that you're lazy? Are you realizing that you like watching TV or video games too much? Is stress causing you to sin? Is being locked in a wife with your house and kids making you angry? Allow God to help you to put habits in place to fix those areas of your character. We're all familiar with 1 John 1:9. Whatever your sin is, confess it, and it will be forgiven. Is there a habit tonight that you're not willing to give up? Is there a sin that you're not willing to give up? As the song says, it's when we surrender all. It's when God's will for our life becomes our will for our lives, because we're spending so much time in the word and prayer that we begin to see fruit, that we begin to prosper in ways that we never imagined we could prosper. But it all starts with a guarded mind, being so cautious what you're allowing in, with prayer at the very least twice a day, and with spending time not just reading but studying. And that's when God's mind becomes our mind as we spend time with him. Let's close in prayer. Father, I know the lesson tonight was about as simple as it could get. Lord, I just ask that you would use it, Father God, that you would help somebody in here to get rid of a habit you don't want them to have, that you would help somebody in here to really commit, to drill down into spending time with you every day. In your name we pray. Amen. So, now is the time when we pray, and I have gotten a couple of prayer requests here on my phone. And if you are in the live chat, Josh is logged into the live chat, and you can type something there and he can holler it out to us. I'd like to start. I had asked you last week to pray for a pastor that my wife's family knows, very godly man, because he was diagnosed with COVID-19 and they did not think he would live. And he has at this point gone home to be with the Lord. So I would just ask that you pray now for the family, that God will give grace and comfort. That's the Farver family. Many of you know God blessed us in a good way. My son tore his toe open pretty significantly, and if you want, I can show you the picture afterwards, but it was bad enough that I was pretty sure I couldn't patch it up. And when he got to the ER, they were super concerned that the toe was broken on the inside of the skin because the skin was cut back so hard. They did a couple of x-rays and decided it was okay, and it took him 40 minutes to put in only 7 stitches because it was such a mess. But the huge praise with all of that is my son was the only person in the ER. So it was not one of those experiences where you're there for the entire day, and he was treated well. So that's a huge praise. In relation to what's going on in my life, I have one more prayer request. As I was on the way here, my dad called me, and my grandpa, who I'm really close to, he fell, hurt himself pretty bad. He broke his hip. And they took him to the ER, with all the COVID rules. He had to be alone in the ER. And they found out that he broke his hip. And they decided, which is really perplexing to me, if one of you nurses wants to text me, you have a thought on this, feel free. He's got a broken hip, and they're going to do nothing about it. It just doesn't seem like the normal to me. And because he has a broken hip, obviously he can't take care of himself, and they can't send him home to be with grandma because grandma's in her late 70s, early 80s too, so she can't help him. So in the morning they're going to transfer him alone from the hospital to being alone in an adult care facility, and grandma won't be able to visit him there either. So if you would just pray for my grandparents, because they have not spent, in the 50-plus years they've been married, very much time apart from each other. So anybody else? I've got some prayer requests here on my phone if we don't have anything. Miss Vicky says, praise the Lord, she is almost at 100%. She said her sister's friend Sonia, her father's wife, succumbed to COVID-19. Sonia went to Louisiana to help her dad with the funeral arrangements and everything, and she really had to do it all for him because he was so despondent. He passed away last night, they think of a heart attack. Sonia is so upset. Please pray for her and her husband as they try to get things done. Anybody else tonight? Josh, how are your job interviews going? So that could be pretty dicey. Amen. So pray that the folks from West Florida get back with you and that God works that situation out, that your previous guy speaks positively of you, that all works out. Pastor Davis.
Debbie wanted me to mention about her dad.
For sure.
His left hip had the bone cancer in it, and they've done all the radiation and chemo. I think he has a few more chemo treatments to go, but now they're finding out that his right hip has been in a lot of pain as well.
Oh, no.
And so we're not sure why.
Right. Right.
The right side is hurting. And so please pray for him. It just
sure.
Seems like it's getting worse.
For sure.
He's very, very discouraged.
Okay.
So please pray for that. Also, want to give you a quick update. I got a phone call from Brother Sloan yesterday.
Okay.
And he filled me in on stuff that he had heard, and I wanted to pass it on to you. Of course, because of the COVID, the South Dakota never closed down their state. I heard about the governor there, it's a woman. She decided not to close her state down, but gave people the opportunity to act responsibly, social distancing.
Right.
She said the biggest problem, though, was one of the pork processing plants, Smithfield.
Right.
One of the largest pork processing plants in the United States, or Smithfield Hams, whatever.
Bacon.
They are going bankrupt, shutting down.
Right.
So as a result of that, trickling down from there, the concern is pork prices probably will be skyrocketing.
For sure.
And then also other beef and chicken prices may skyrocket as well.
Right.
As a result. So his word was, and I agree, that if you can, you might want to stock up.
For sure.
Stock up on meat products that you can freeze if you have a freezer.
Right.
Because things may be changing in the next week or so as this kind of trickles down.
Right.
Just to keep that in mind, an announcement for everybody.
Yeah, for sure. So for those out there in internet land, Pastor talked to Steve Sloan, and they were talking about the situation with the Smithfield meat plant and how it shut down. It's one of the main meat plants in America. So it would seem a logical conclusion that if that shut down, that the prices of meat, pork, are probably going to go up. So just as a caution, if you're in a place where you can, the Lord will provide for you. Go ahead and get you some meat, because within the next week, you might not be able to afford it anymore. Any other prayer requests tonight? I see one here. Pray for those affected by the tornado. Kayla, my sister-in-law, her family is in a hospital being monitored for blood pressure and vertigo. So let's keep that in prayer. Titus. Amen.
Prayer request. My neighbors have been home a lot more. Several of them with the social distancing in different places closing.
Right.
And that has given Brenda and also me a little bit a chance to talk to some of them a little bit more.
Awesome.
Before this happened, we were burdened to reach out to our neighbors a little more than we have, especially the gospel. So, especially one of my neighbors I want to ask prayer for. She is a little bit older. She lives by herself. And she had a guy pressure washing her house. And I guess it was one of her good friend's friends. And we saw him out there getting some work done.
Right.
And she talked to him like a day later and said that he passed away.
Oh, wow.
Heart attack.
Wow.
Suddenly.
Right. Wow.
Very sudden as well. So we've mentioned that Brenda said that she was talking to her about that, and she was mentioning that we have a hope of heaven and so on after death, and she said, honey, I do pray all the time.
Right, right.
But so we may have saved neighbors
for sure. Yeah. Martha. So pray for Titus and his neighbors. He's had more opportunity to witness because they've been around more because of the situation. And one of his neighbors, particularly Miss Martha, has had two folks very close to her die. So just pray for the opportunity there to witness. Josh. Oh, yeah, yeah. Okay, that's Sharon's sister, Christy. Christy needs prayer. Her body aches, and she has a headache. Please have the church pray. So she is also sick. Anybody else? All right, with that, let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father God, Lord, we just want to thank you so much that you are a God who hears prayer, who answers prayer. Lord, we want to thank you that we have the ability to come to you anytime, day or night. Lord, that you don't have office hours, Father, that your ears are never closed. Lord, I want to come before you tonight, Father, and thank you for Miss Vicky, Lord God, and thank you for the fact that she is doing much better with Corona. Lord, we ask that you would continue to heal her, continue to help her. Father God, we want to ask that you would be with her friend, Sister Sonia, Lord God, and the situation with their family and the deaths there, Lord. We want to ask that you would give grace and give wisdom as they try to accomplish the things that they need to accomplish. Lord, we want to ask that you be with Titus and Brenda and their opportunity to be able to witness to their neighbors. Father, we want to ask that you be with Dr. Lucas, Lord. He was only able to sleep lying on one side, and Father, Lord, now that side aches, and he can't lay on the other side because that side aches. Lord, I just ask that you would give the doctors wisdom, Lord, that you'd just give Dr. Lucas great mercy, Father God, that you would allow him to just sense your very presence as he tries to sleep at night. Lord, that you would comfort him in a way that we can't understand and in a way that we can't comfort. But Father, we know that the Holy Spirit has that ability. And Lord, I ask the same for my grandparents right now, for Floyd and Pearl DeLosh, Lord, that you would help Grandpa as he's alone in a hospital with a broken hip. Lord, we just ask that you'd give great grace. And Father, we ask that you'd give grace to Grandma because, Lord, we know she wants to be there with Grandpa and she can't. Father, we ask that you will be with Christy. She's not doing so well. Father, we ask that you'd help them to know what to do about that. Lord, we ask that you be with those who are hurt by the tornado. Father, we ask that you be with Miss Terry as she's not doing well with vertigo either. Lord, we want to come before you and thank you because, Father, many of us have a job. And, Lord, we know that that's only by your grace, by your mercy. And, Father, we want to praise you for that we still have a job. Lord, we want to ask that you would give us wisdom, Father God, with this meat plant shutting down. Lord, we don't know quite what to do. Father, we want to be wise. We want to be judicious. Lord, if we ought stock up, give us the wisdom to be able to stock up. Help us to be able to find that meat to stock up on. Lord, now it seems even finding any meat is somewhat scarce. So, Father, give us wisdom. Lord, give us those things that we need. Father, help us as the time gets worse to draw close to you and to be willing to help each other. Lord, we thank you for how you're going to answer these prayers. Father, we thank you for the opportunity that we have, Lord. We thank you for the equipment, Father. Over the last year, we bought this piece and that piece, trying to make it sure that we'd be able to communicate on the internet. Lord, we had no idea how critical it was going to be. But Lord, as we bought those pieces over time, you knew. And we want to thank you for that, Lord God. Help us to be able to continue to do those things. In your name we pray. Amen.